Well, good afternoon and welcome to this meeting. My name is Michael Keating. I'm a professor at the Universities of Aberdeen and Edinburgh, and I'm director of the Centre on Constitutional Change, which is the body that is hosting this meeting. Now, the Centre on Constitutional Change was set up 3 or 4 years ago to... I'm very good at turning my phone off. The thing is, I never remember to turn it back on again. There we are. The Centre on Constitutional Change was set up originally to look at the issues surrounding the Scottish independence referendum of 2014. We had a lot of meetings like this. We were talking to both sides. We did blogs. We did opinion pieces. We travelled around the country. We did some academic publications trying to explore the implications of the referendum votes and get our ideas out to the people, get people, citizens, engaged in this debate on the basis of whatever information we could try and provide them. We don't count ourselves as experts. Even before Michael Gove notoriously dismissed the idea of experts, we didn't say that we're experts. We're merely academics who maybe have some skill in communicating ideas and getting debates going and helping citizens to think through issues for themselves. And we thought after the Scottish referendum, that would be it. Indeed, our sponsors in the Research Council said, that's it, the Constitution is over. We knew that wasn't true. And then along comes the Brexit debate, and that has implications for Scotland in addition to the implications for the UK. So we started all over again. And at the moment, we have an active programme of activities in our centre, in another programme that I am associated with called the UK in a Changing Europe programme. And if you want information, if you want to get into a little more detail about what the implications of Brexit are, you can go to our website here. That links to the various other websites that have blogs, analysis papers, discussions, and so on about what Brexit means. Now, this afternoon, we've got a panel of MSPs. We've got some academics. The academics have been told to talk for no more than 5 minutes just to throw ideas out there because we want to hear from you. This is an interactive event, and we want to hear from you about your ideas and where you think Brexit is going because some of us haven't got the faintest idea where it's going. So not only are we not experts in the first place, but we really, no matter how much you know about this, the more you know, the less you know in some ways. So that's what we're going to do for the afternoon. I'll hand over now to Henry McLeish, the former First Minister and long-standing friend of our centre, who is going to chair the afternoon's proceedings.
Well, thanks very much, Michael, and a warm welcome to you for the conference this afternoon. Just a bit of housekeeping. There's no tests planned for fire, but in the event of a fire alarm, one of the marshals will direct you to the fire exits in the biosphere. And I'm not sure whether the biosphere is more combustible than other parts of the place, but just go with some caution when the alarm bells ring. As Michael has said, we're very pleased today to have, you know, an excellent and expert group of parliamentarians from the European External Relations Committee. And we're also blessed to have some of the best academics in Britain, both on the platform and in the audience, to look at these momentous changes that are taking place in Europe, in European, British, and Scottish politics. And I think today's purpose, as Michael said, is to unravel some of the issues, huge complex set of issues, and also try and understand some of the consequences. Now, we may not complete that in 3 hours of discussion, but hopefully the gathering today will be an opportunity for you to have your say and to start off yet another major debate in Scotland about where we're heading as the years unfold ahead of us. So, as I said, the first part of the today's proceedings is the panel. There's going to be an hour for that, 5 minute contribution from each of our MSPs, and then we'll have half an hour of questions. So I'm going to try and be very courteous and try to keep everybody to time because it's a very tight programme, action-packed, as they say, but I'm looking forward to what I think will be a fascinating afternoon, which, as I said, will focus on these momentous changes that are taking place at the present time. So without further ado, I'd like to ask Joan McAlpine, who is the convener of the European and External Relations Committee, to address conference. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Henry, and thank you very much to the Centre for giving us this opportunity today. I am convener, as Henry said, of the European and External Relations Committee, which after the Brexit vote was expanded to ensure that it reflected the complete political composition of the Parliament. So every party in the Parliament is represented on the committee. It's now 3 months since 51.9% of those who voted in the EU referendum voted to leave the EU. And of course, in Scotland, 62% of voters cast their vote to remain in the EU. And our committee immediately embarked on a programme of work to examine the implications of the vote for Scotland. That decision was made against the background of a vote in the Scottish Parliament, giving the First Minister authority to explore means of maintaining the benefits to Scotland of its relationship with the European Union, including access to the single market. The period during which we've carried out our deliberations has been characterised by uncertainty, and the new Prime Minister has confirmed the binding nature of the result of the referendum, emphasising that Brexit means Brexit, but what that means remains a mystery. Mrs May has indicated that the UK government won't trigger the withdrawal process until 2017, but it's unclear exactly what role the Scottish government will have in shaping any deal, and that's something that we explored with the First Minister during our recent evidence session with the committee. The UK government has said it wants to hear views from Scotland, so although we don't know the process as to how that's actually going to be expressed, we feel our committee can be a useful forum. So we have opened up a general call for evidence, which has had a very heartening response. We've already had over 150 different pieces of evidence, which we are currently analysing. Over the summer, we also gathered some oral evidence by speaking to different sectors and academic experts. We took evidence from economists, constitutional lawyers, diplomats, businessmen, trade unions, and overwhelmingly the evidence that we took over the summer suggested deep concern about loss of access to the single market in terms of inward investment, free movement of capital, labour and goods and services. There were some dissenting voices to that view. The Scottish Fishermen's Association, for example, said Brexit did provide an opportunity to manage marine resources more effectively. And during our visit to Brussels over the summer, we discussed the EFTA-EEA option, which, while it would leave the UK outside the customs union, does give access to the single market. But that does appear to have been ruled out by the Prime Minister. The committee is going to look at this further and examine other options further, including things like bespoke trade agreements or a reversion to WTO rules, which, given some of the advice that we've received, may be what happens even if we do go for a free trade agreement, because certainly the opinion that many of us have heard is that we can't negotiate a free trade agreement until after the Article 50 process is over. So we will have to look at that over the next few weeks and look at what could be least damaging to Scotland's interests. And we'll also investigate how Scotland might enjoy a different relationship with the EU that reflects its interests. And during her evidence to the committee last week, the First Minister said that that's a piece of work that her standing council of experts is looking at, and they will bring forward some options. We've heard lots about reverse Greenlands and so on, but I think there are many more options that we can look at. So we'll look forward to hearing what the Standing Council says about that. As I said earlier, it's unclear where Scotland will stand in negotiations, and that's an area which requires investigation along with the Article 50 process, the position of EU citizens, and the long-term impact on our economy. Our committee needs to speak to an even wider range of sectors and explore more fully some of the concerns already raised with us. So I'd like to thank the organisations and individuals who have engaged with the committee so far. Our initial report focused on the evidence that we've received over the summer. Overwhelmingly, that report reflected the fact that access to the single market was of deep concern. Going forward, how the funds that come directly to Scotland via the Treasury but come to Scotland from the EU, how are they going to be distributed after the UK leaves the EU? Because the Barnett formula, as we've been told, is not an effective means for getting those funds to Scotland. It doesn't actually reflect some, for example, the Common Agricultural Policy funds are give us a far greater share than our population, which we would get under Barnett. So it's we're very much a rolling investigation, if you like, and we're going to be bringing out more reports as we look at different aspects of how Brexit impacts on Scotland. It's becoming clear that the UK government appears to be pursuing a hard Brexit. So that's certainly the case in terms of the Prime Minister's comments yesterday at the UN. So WTO rules, the implications of hard Brexit is something that we'll be looking at. Speaking from a party political point of view, I would be very concerned about how Scotland will feature in any trade negotiations, for example. We've heard quite a lot about the fact that the UK doesn't actually have expertise in trade negotiations. But even if that expertise is built up, my concern would be, and people have raised this with us, how are Scotland's economic sectors going to be reflected in informal or formal talks about trade? How are our interests going to be represented? So there's clearly a great deal of work for our committee to do. And I'd like to thank you again for the opportunity to be able to address you today. Thank you.
Lewis.
Thank you very much. I'm Lewis MacDonald, the Deputy Convener of the Committee and the Labour Member on the Committee. And I just want in these 5 minutes to lay out some of the perspectives, if you like, from my party, but also from the evidence that we have obtained thus far and the witnesses who have come to talk to us. And much of what Joan said, I think I would reflect on in much the same way. It has been clear from a whole range of witnesses and a whole range of evidence that the impact of Britain leaving the European Union on the Scottish economy and on Scottish life will be very significant indeed. In fact, I'm sure I'm not the only one in this room who can envision or visualise Britain's membership of the European Union in terms of my adult working life and experience. I was still at school when Britain joined the European community back in the 70s. At the way things are going, I will be somewhere in my 60s by the time we leave, although exactly where I think remains to be seen. Because what's most, for me and for my generation, this is truly a generational challenge. It is Britain's membership of the EU has defined and focused much of my generation's experience of working life and the way in which the country has developed over that time. We're in a very different place in many ways from before we joined. So the question is, what is the process of exit going to look like? What will the impact of that be? I guess my first point would be to say that we have come to a place which has very serious implications, and I fear we've come there entirely by accident. Jackson Carlow will speak for his own party and for himself. But I think any observer watching the response of those who campaigned for Brexit on the morning after the vote would second the view that many of them were as surprised as those who had campaigned to remain by the result. Therefore, from whatever perspective Brexit is seen, there has been and there is no plan for going forward to the next stage. And I think from my perspective as a member of the committee looking at what Scotland's options might be, the thing that first strikes you is that it is completely unclear what the United Kingdom government actually aspires to achieve on the back of leaving the European Union. Is it membership of the single market? I heard Joan say on the basis of what Theresa May said yesterday, absolutely not. Well, sometimes it depends which Tory minister you listen to and when you listen to them. It seems to me completely unclear, and I'm not at all certain that Theresa May has a formed strategy in mind, even in her own head, far less agreed around the cabinet table. Therefore, if those questions are not answered, if we don't know whether membership of the single market is the aspiration of the UK government, it then makes life clearly difficult for those of us who are seeking to influence the outcome here in Scotland. The Scottish government has set off to explore options. They've done that with my party support and broad support across the Parliament, because we think it's important to understand what those options might be. But the single most important thing in that process is to know what it is the UK government are offering to involve Scottish ministers in. They've said, let's have the devolved administration, Scotland and Wales and other administrations, involved in the process, but we don't know to what end. So I think there are questions for the UK government. There are also questions for the Scottish government. They said in debate in Parliament last week that the single market was the central objective for Scotland. We need to know, does that mean if the UK negotiates a deal that remains in the single market, is that then the mandate of Parliament to explore options, has that then been delivered? But we also, I think, in a final point, in considering all the options for both the UK and Scottish governments, we also need to have in mind that 1 million people in Scotland did vote to leave the European Union. Now, we can talk, and I'm sure we will, about who voted that way and why. But let's not pretend those of us who were advocates and strong advocates of Remain and are looking for ways to remain engaged as closely as possible with the European Union and the European Economic Area, let us not pretend that the European Union is an unblemished good and is something without room for improvement. Clearly, that would not be the case. And whatever the outcome we achieve, we should seek to make it one that commands support both from those who voted to leave and from those who voted to remain.
Thanks very much, Lewis. Jackson?
Thank you, Henry. I mean, in the 40 years I've been actively involved in politics, there has been a tremendous growth in political academics, political professors, sophologists. I don't really remember any of these people all existing and debating all these matters with great authority all those years ago. And throughout all of that period, one of the things that struck me is that when we've got to elections, we've very often been told it's absolutely impossible for this side or that side to win an election, because the scale of the swing that would be required would require us to beat everything that's ever been achieved in political history before now, and it won't happen, and then it does. And the conclusion I've come to is that the British public, one way or another, are able to engineer the result in most elections that actually they want. And it's not for me to second guess that. It's not for me to assert that I understand why they did or why they didn't. It's for me to accept that, in fact, that was the national expression of popular will. Sometimes it's certainly not been the result that I looked for. And in this particular referendum, I campaigned on the Remain side. But because we don't have a written constitution, because we don't have any of the kind of... because everything is almost a precedent. And this, the consequences of the result that we've just seen, we're already being told will lead to all manner of different precedents. I tell you now what I think is going to happen, because I think that's where we have to go from here. I think that, by and large, the people of the United Kingdom will pragmatically adjust to the result. And in the way that people in the United Kingdom do when set a challenge, they will now say, well, how on earth do we make a success of the challenge that has now been set for us? And it is in our collective interest that we make a success of it. There's no point, if you were somebody who was on the other side of this argument and campaign to remain, there's no point in sort of taking a huff now and saying, well, I'm going to ensure the whole thing's a disastrous outcome, because that collectively would be to the detriment of every one of us here. We now need to make a success of it. So I think what will happen is that Scotland, as part of the United Kingdom, will leave the European Union. I'm not sure when that will be. I think there is a debate about when the process begins. Last week we had the former European President, Mr. Van Rompuy, saying no meaningful discussions would take place until after the German elections. Well, that's a factor, because if 11 months next year of the 24 months we have, if we triggered it in January, were meaningless in terms of discussion, there wouldn't be much point in triggering the Article 50. So I'm not sure when that will happen. But I believe when it does happen, a negotiation will take place, that the European Union now expects that Britain is going to leave, and that what is in our collective interest is to ensure that Scotland, together with Northern Ireland, who also voted against, Wales and London, which also voted against, and the whole of the United Kingdom, gets the best possible deal out of those negotiations. And therefore, I think that while there's lots of interesting speculation and talk, and I may be proved wrong, If that core reality is the truth, what is absolutely fundamental now is that the Scottish Government is absolutely at the heart of the discussions that take place. Now, constitutional experts have made clear, in fact, it's foreign affairs is a reserved matter. It would be perfectly appropriate for the UK government to say we're not involving any of the devolved administrations at all. It's our responsibility and we are going ahead with it. It would be untenable, but I mean, in technical terms, it's correct. Instead of which, the United Kingdom government has said no. It's fundamentally important now that each of the devolved administrations is intimately involved and at the heart of the negotiating strategy we have going forward. And I was struck when we were in Brussels meeting various European ambassadors to the European Union. But many of them said, look, there is a differential deal for Scotland to achieve out of the discussions that are going to take place. There are European governments that will talk to Scotland about the aspects of any negotiated withdrawal where there could be a differentiated settlement for Scotland. But the lead nation in all of this, the member state, is the United Kingdom. And therefore, it will be fundamentally important to other European nations that they believe Scotland is working politically along with the other devolved administrations in these negotiations so that the Westminster government feels able to say to other European nations, yes, have those discussions. The expression that was used, and it was very straightforward, is if that doesn't happen, the shutters will come down all over Europe to any separate discussions taking place with Scotland. And that, I think, would be unfortunate in the extreme, because there are clear areas where I think different settlement could be arrived at. Beyond that, and finally, I think that as a consequence of leaving, we also have to think which of the responsibilities Europe has ought now to become the direct responsibility of us here in Scotland and not be matters which are subsequently agreed at Westminster on agriculture, on fishing, on areas that the European Union currently has responsibility for, where we could shape here in Scotland a package which was absolutely and directly of interest to our fishermen, our farmers. So those areas too, I think, will be very important in the discussions that now take place. I've no idea when they're going to start. I've no idea where they're going to end. There's a whole world out there that we're going to have to re-engage with beyond the European Union. But I actually think that once we've set our mind to it, that's the channel, that will become the focus of our discussion. And that the united purpose of everybody, whatever political persuasion they come from, is that we make a success of that.
Thanks very much, Jackson. Now, Scott.
Ross.
Sorry, Ross, my apologies.
The challenge at an event like this, once you get this far in the panel, is to actually say something new. So this might be a shorter contribution than others, but I'll give it a go. I mean, I'll be honest, I come at this from an existing constitutional position. I've always believed that an independent Scotland with a seat at the European table is the best option for the people that live here. And most people that are going into the debate that we're in now, post-Brexit, in Scotland, already come at it with a very set position on our own constitutional question. That has a huge bearing on where the debate goes. I am interested in all the options short of a second independence referendum. As much as I ultimately think this is going to come down to a choice between two unions, which one do the people of Scotland want to be part of, it is worth exploring and exhausting all the options short of it. Reverse Greenland being the most oft-cited example. But I don't find it particularly convincing. It's not a surprise to say that Greenland and Scotland are not particularly comparable. And that applies just as much to the examples that people who were on the Leave side and want to get the best possible outcome for their own position are talking about as well. There's been a suggestion that the UK should push for access to the single market without the full sign up to the principle of freedom of movement. And they cite Liechtenstein as an example. Well, that's not remotely comparable to the UK either. It's about the size of a third of a Holyrood constituency. There's more companies registered there than there are people living there. So we're citing a lot of examples that aren't actually particularly comparable to either Scotland or the United Kingdom, because we're in a situation that no one's ever been in before. The primary author of Article 50 said not a few weeks ago he never expected it to be triggered. He's not sure how it's going to go either. So we're playing with entirely new ground here. And as much as these options, short of a second choice, are very legally challenging, and people have talked about them simply being legally impossible, I think that misses the point. And I think often we're having a debate about what's legally possible when the reality of this situation is it's going to be about where the political will is. The political will in Europe at the moment is not forgiving the UK whatever sweetheart deal we decide we want. There is no will for that from our European partners. When you've got the heads of government from multiple nations saying that, the incoming presidency saying that, the heads of various institutions saying that, I think we can all agree that the will simply isn't there to give us what David Davis or Liam Fox or whomever within the UK government wants. But that presents a challenge to us in Scotland as well, because we're potentially seeking a deal that's very different to that of the rest of the UK, adding a whole new level of complexity to it. And the other point that I would make is that I feel that we moved from what we all regarded as a very poor quality debate during the referendum to a debate now which isn't necessarily any better. And Lewis brought it up. For those of us on the Remain side, there's a huge challenge here in continuing to be positive about the European Union. We still believe that the UK should be part of it, whether or not it's going to be. I think Jackson's right, the UK is going to leave the European Union. The question is what constituent parts still make up the UK at that point. But we need to acknowledge the European Union is significantly flawed, whether it's its response to the refugee crisis, the lack of transparency, poorly written trade deals, dodgy trade deals, or the fact that freedom of movement, as a principle that we've spent a lot of time defending, is at the moment not driven by the freedom of the individual to live, work and study wherever they want. It's driven by economic forces across the continent that push people to places that they weren't necessarily going to go to. So it's a huge challenge for those of us who are still positive about the potential for Europe to acknowledge that it's a seriously flawed institution. It's so flawed that a million people in Scotland voted to leave, and we need to, whilst continuing to fight for Scotland's place within Europe, some kind of satisfactory continued relationship, acknowledge why a million people here in the most pro-EU part of the UK still voted to leave. We're not going to be in the driving seat within Europe in the next couple of years. The idea that we can continue to push for reform whilst facing the exit door is just not one that's going to go anywhere. But if Scotland can manage to secure some kind of significant relationship, continued relationship with the European Union, we do need to prioritise reform, because the EU as it is not satisfactory. It's not satisfactory regardless of the political position you come from, and people voted to leave for a huge variety of reasons. It's far too simplistic to say that it was a referendum on immigration. For a huge number of people it was, for others it was on an abstract idea of sovereignty, for other people it was simply an anti-establishment vote, and there were a range of other issues there. But for those of us who are committed to staying in Europe, we need to engage with the million people here who voted to leave to find out why and to understand what kind of Europe they want to be part of, what kind of role they want Scotland to play in the world. That's a challenge that we've not quite faced up to yet.
Thanks very much, Ross. Last but not least, Tavish.
Thank you very much, Henry. Firstly, I'd like to congratulate Nicola McEwen and Michael Keating on spotting the one area of growth, economic growth, that has happened because of the decision on the 23rd of June, and that's to create conferences to discuss ad nauseam, something that's going to go on for years and years and years. Michael said in his introduction that we don't have the faintest idea of where we're going. I think this is like the Joey Barton approach to the future of the world. It's a complete gamble. And none of us do know indeed. I'm not going to copy everything my colleagues have said, but to echo just one or two points. The first is, this is a political process. There are 15 elections across different member states over the next 2 years, the French and German elections being the most important next year. There is also a referendum in Hungary just next month on the 2nd of October, and a election runoff for the presidential position in Austria as well. And remember how well that went last time. So when we talk about Europe, one of the aspects that was discussed in Parliament last week, but I don't think is getting enough attention, is I'm not terribly sure I know what Europe's going to look like in 2 years, never mind what the United Kingdom looks like or what the constituent parts of the United Kingdom looks like either. But what I do know is that Merkel had a pretty tough night at the polls the other night, and if she decides either not to stand or if she is weakened by the rise of the right in Germany, Europe is a very different place after the German federal elections next September than the country and the nation and the block of nations that we currently see. Two other points. The UK government is fundamentally split on its position. I can't think of anything in my political life where a government hasn't a clue what it's doing, because they are from the Atlanticists of Fox and Davis across to the pragmatists and the reasonable Conservatives, who actually know that this is a huge gamble and pretty well an economic disaster for the United Kingdom. And putting that together, even under our pragmatic Prime Minister that I suspect Theresa May is probably the most challenging bit of politics that any of us are ever going to witness. I'm not personally sure it's going to happen. Theresa May, Tusk said in Downing Street the other day, they will trigger Article 50 in the early part of next year. I am not so sure, not just because of the German elections, which are far more important actually than what's happening in the UK at the moment in the context of Europe, but actually more because I'm not sure the Conservative government can get their act together and come to an agreement, never mind the position of the Scottish government, the Welsh government, and indeed our friends in Northern Ireland as well. So even trying to guess when the UK government get their act together and have a negotiating position, I think is a long game too. Two final points, Henry, if I may. The first is, I don't think there's any doubt that the economic consequences for both Scotland and for the UK are bad. From Brexit. Yesterday, there was a very serious piece of work done looking at groups of managers across different representative business organisations who absolutely concluded that their confidence was shaken to its core by what was going to happen in the coming years. Yes, is it okay now? Some numbers come out. Does it look a little easier? It may at the moment. But I don't think there's any doubt that when Article 50 is triggered, then the consequences for our economy are very significant indeed. And my final point is, I just did not understand Nicola Sturgeon's article on Sunday when she said that independence transcends everything else, including oil, Brexit, the economy, and jobs. I did not understand that, not for all the obvious political reasons about independence, but actually because she's been making the Brexit argument in the context of Scotland every day since the 23rd of March. So why suddenly make the opposite argument that actually Brexit doesn't matter, the only thing that matters is independence? I just maybe ask you to ponder that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure in a distinguished audience like this, not everybody knows who Joey Barton is, but he currently plays for Rangers. I underline the currently. Anyway, let's not dwell there. Let's not be controversial. Well, different approaches, different politics. So we've half an hour for questions. Please direct a question to an individual MSP, or if you want a collective decision or response, that's fine as well. And maybe rank and number before you ask. Okay, who's first? Lady here.
I wanted to ask the whole panel a question which really comes out of something Joan McAlpin said, because she was talking about Article 50, if it's triggered at the start of 2017, would take 2 years, and that's probably not enough time to negotiate whatever the full trade deal is, the special relationship of Britain with Europe in the future. So there might be a transitional deal, that may or may not be a WTO deal. So We're talking in the UK as a whole, and then in Scotland, about potentially two second referendums. Will there be a second referendum on Brexit? Will there be a second referendum on independence? Because that would have to happen before the start of 2019, unless it does take longer for Article 50 to happen. So does the panel expect that Scotland will be out of the EU by the start of 2019 or not? In other words, doesn't see any second independence referendum before then, as likely. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for the question. I think we'll just go around the panel for a brief comment. Joan?
Do you want me to start?
Yeah.
Yes, well, Kirsty was one of the people that we took evidence from at the very beginning of the process, and I was particularly struck by the evidence that you gave, Kirsty, where you, and it was widely reported in the press as well, where you asserted that if Scotland did vote for independence, I think it would be fast-tracked, and certainly in the conversations that you had in Europe, that the people were talking about a holding pen for Scotland, so it wouldn't be out and then back in again. The answer to your, I thought I was very struck by that evidence, is the answer to your question is I don't know if there would be an independence referendum before then. Certainly, despite what Tavish has just said, everything that the First Minister has said so far suggests that an independence referendum is very much a kind of like on the back burner, and the priority just now is to secure the best possible deal for Scotland. I think one of the difficulties is that we don't actually know what Scotland's position is going to be within negotiations, and that's something that we're going to explore this week in the committee's evidence with some expert witnesses, in terms of, you know, what are the intergovernment relationships going to be? Are they going to be effective? Is Scotland just going to be a consultee? Or are we actually going to be fully engaged in shaping the deal? And I just wanted to respond to Jackson's comment about the ambassadors that we met in Europe, who made it clear that the shutters would come down unless the UK government said that the Scottish government was able to negotiate directly with UK states. So the Scottish government's had a very warm reception, as you know, from UK states. But I would say to Jackson, you know, well, you know, you tell your colleagues at UK government level that they have to give out that message loud and clear to other EU governments to talk to Scotland so that we can have that differentiated relationship, because I haven't heard the UK government actually sending out that message. So I'm really pleased actually that Jackson has repeatedly raised it in the chamber last week, and I hope that his colleagues in the UK government are listening to him.
Lewis, independence referendum, Brexit referendum, and when?
There are no certainties in any of this, but I think we're getting pretty close to certainty in saying, no, I don't think there will be an independence referendum before the beginning of 2019, nor do I think British withdrawal from Europe will be complete by then either. The term of the European Parliament and European Commission are respectively June and October 2019. I think practical political operators, civil servants at the highest level, will have those dates very much in mind. But the political reality is that none of that can start until the UK has made up its mind what it wants, and it's not making any coherent position clear. Jackson talked about we now need to make a success of it, but we don't know what it actually looks like. Is it the single market? Is it complete separation from the European Economic Area or not? We don't know that yet, and so I don't think that process will be underway by then. I think in terms of the independence referendum, the one thing Nicola Sturgeon's been consistent about is that she has no intention of calling an independence referendum unless or until she thinks she can win. And there's no evidence at all that position has changed. The evidence we've seen so far suggests a very marginal shift, but still very much a minority position in favour of independence. And even among the people polled who say they favour independence, quite a large number of them don't want a referendum anytime soon. I think people have had enough of referendums, frankly. I think there's a sense, certainly on the doorstep, when I was talking to people in June and since the 23rd of June, that process has been pursued ad nauseam in both the Scottish and the UK context. What they now want is some clarity about what governments are going to do with the decisions that have been made. A referendum that says we're going to leave the European Union but doesn't say what we're going to do about the single market leaves us in with the uncertainties we know about. And my view is there will not be a sufficient demand to prompt the government to go for an independence referendum either.
Thanks very much, Lewis. Jackson?
Start at the end. I mean, one of the things that made the 2014 independence campaign so acute and intense was in fact opinion polls showing that it was a very, very close result. And that probably was what stimulated the highest turnout we'd ever seen in a democratic election here in Scotland. But what people tend to overlook when they refer to polls, and I've seen advocates saying, look, the tide is moving in favour of independence in the polls today, is that in 2014, not one single poll, not one, put the no vote above 50%. Not one. And the final vote was 55.3% no, well out with the 3% plus or minus margin of error. So I wonder, in fact, had the actual result been one that people had anticipated throughout the campaign, if it would have been as intense. And I see no real shift in that. And so for all the rhetoric that goes about, I don't expect there to be another independence referendum anytime soon, if at all, frankly. The first part of the question, though, I think is the more interesting one, and that is, will we have left by 2019? And Tavish talked about the many elections that are going to take place across the European Union. I touched on Mr. Van Rompuy saying that nothing meaningful could happen until after the German election. Well, I don't know. I mean, if we do trigger Article 50 at the beginning of 2017, because despite what people are saying, the various devolved administrations, which the First Minister have said expect to agree the reference terms within which they will be planning Britain's strategy very shortly, if over the balance of the year they move to a point where we can, I think there would be a will in the European Union to actually conclude this discussion sooner rather than later if that proved to be possible. And I could see them looking and saying, well, it'd be better if the whole thing was over and done with by 2019. So I could see that it could happen. Will it happen? I don't know, because I could also see all the challenges that exist, all the complications. I mean, I remember during the 2014 independence referendum, you know, one of the things that became apparent was as each new area of public life was examined, some other relationship came to light around which there was going to be a complicated discussion as to how you separated Scotland and England. And I think that will be equally true of Europe, that we haven't even really scratched the surface of identifying all the things that we're going to have to find a way to try and map a future for. And that might make, as you suggested, I think, a two-tier stage process in this, a sort of exit package for Britain, but with then quite a long period after that where a lot of the detail is subsequently negotiated. Now, if that option came about, then I think 2019 is a possibility, but it would depend on whether or not people felt they wanted the whole thing in every aspect resolved or the key aspects of it resolved, which I think is a possibility without at all being a certainty. None of us here can be certain of anything, I think.
Ross, comment?
I think that there are... The timescale for activation of Article 50 is particularly challenging when you get messages out of Europe. So the example of Herman Van Rompuy talking about the German elections has been cited. There's now a tension in the messages that we're getting. So you have German federal elections in autumn of next year and a European election in June of 2019. We've had a number of figures from Europe say that the negotiations would have to be concluded by that election and the start of the next cycle of European politics. There is less than 2 years between that German federal election and that European election. So you've immediately got a tension there, and something has to give at either end of that process. I've already laid out that I think that there probably will be a second independence referendum. That's particularly the case if the UK is heading towards a hard Brexit. And again, that's debatable whether or not we are. We simply don't know that yet. The hints, I would say, seem to be that are GlaxoSmithKline, who I wouldn't spend a huge amount of time aligning myself with, they are preparing themselves for a hard Brexit. I believe a number of other large companies are. So it's obviously a very distinct possibility. And in that set of circumstances, I think the situation here in Scotland does change utterly. And in terms of our own domestic politics around that, we started off the last independence campaign. I should say the last time I was in this building was the 18th September 2014, because I worked for Yes Scotland, and this was the room that we lost in. So the last time we started an independence campaign, support for independence was at 30% in the polls. This next campaign, if it happens, support for independence starts somewhere between 45% and 50%. That is a totally different ballgame. You take on top of that the fact that the political situation has changed so wildly. You're having it within the very specific context of Scotland voting for independence to hopefully stay in the European Union, or voting no to independence to stay in a UK that leaves the European Union. That's utterly incomparable to the last referendum that we had, and the debate would be entirely different. But our politics has changed so much. Taking that aside, the Labour Party was the muscle behind the last Better Together campaign. That wouldn't be the case anymore, be the Conservative Party. I would imagine there's a harder ceiling on their support and their broad appeal than there is for the Labour Party in Scotland. So trying to look back at the last campaign to compare it to this one, I don't think is particularly helpful. I do think it is likely that there's going to be a second independence referendum. The challenge is timing, because there's a very compelling case that you have it as soon as possible in the Article 50 process to give you time for what are two separate but interrelated sets of negotiations with Europe, one for Scotland becoming independent within Europe, one for the UK leaving, and then that third set between Scotland and the UK. But there's the obvious political arguments that you might want to wait to build support for independence before calling a referendum.
no one's in an easy situation here. I certainly don't envy Nicola Sturgeon's position in making that choice.
Okay, Ross, thanks very much. Tavish?
I find it deliciously ironic that the SNP seem to have as many positions on when the independence referendum on Scotland will be as the Tories do have on what Brexit means. But Kirsty, you asked two questions. The first is, will we be out of the EU by 2019? No, I don't think we will, because I think it's all going to take a lot longer. I think Mike Russell's been appointed not just for this Parliament, but for the next Parliament as well. I think the idea this is all going to happen quickly is not in the real world of European politics, never mind United Kingdom politics. And the second question you asked, which none of my colleagues have touched on, is should there be a second referendum on Brexit itself, on the deal? And there's a perfectly respectful intellectual argument for that. Unlike the Scottish referendum, when I think in fairness everyone knew that what we were voting for, the government had produced a white paper, so on and so forth, there was any number of learned conferences such as this to discuss what independence would mean. The country knew what it was voting for. I don't think the majority of people who voted across the UK knew what they were voting for on the 23rd of June. So there is an argument to say that when the deal is finally negotiated and we all know what it is and the UK government present that to the country, people should be given the option to vote on that. Is it good, yes or no? I don't think that's what's going to happen, but there's a good intellectual argument for it to be the case.
Thanks, Tavish. Next question, gentleman here. Oh, yeah, I'll come to you. Oh, hang on. Gentleman at the back and then I'll come to the gentleman at the front.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Since you've got the microphone.
My name is Fred Hess, a student at Edinburgh University, History and Politics. My question is about legitimacy. To ask the panel, how legitimate do they think the referendum result actually was? At 23 minutes past five in the morning, David Dimbleby called it a resounding writ of victory for the Leave campaign. The results came out at 17,400,000 people voting to leave and 16,200,000 voting to remain, which was 51.8 versus 48.2. The 66 million people in the UK are affected by the relationship between British and European legislation. So the votes of 1,200,000 people are likely then to affect in one way, better or worse, the lives of 66 million citizens of the UK. So a question, how legitimate the referendum result was in that respect. And given that, for example, the 1979 devolution vote needed to surmount a 40% rule, which was an amendment to the bill, the United Nations Security Council has a veto for five permanent members. The EU itself uses qualified majority voting for major changes of a constitutional nature. The question is about, you know, how legitimate is the result of a referendum at one point in time? And, for example, would snap general election with a party committed one way or the other in their manifesto trump that as a...
Okay, I think we've got the gist of the question, sir. Thanks very much. Tavish, take that one and I think also answer the point that that question about legitimacy in terms of majority. And the other idea is, do we now need a written constitution to save the people from the politicians?
Is it legitimate? Yes, it is, on the basis of the rules we fought it under. Should there have been a bar, as you suggested, and has been used in the past? Well, yes, there could have been, but that's not what it was. So I guess I'm in the world of what's happened and dealing with that, rather than in, if I may say so, a perfectly intellectually, again, interesting academic discussion that we could have all afternoon about legitimacy. And to be honest, life's too short, so we've got to move on from where we are. My view is the second referendum on the deal now should happen, but I won't win that argument out. There's no way. I suspect the UK government will concede that. So that's my answer on that. On your second point, Henry, yes, of course. I mean, you'd hardly expect a Liberal Democrat not to argue for a written constitution. And yes, it would save us from people like me.
Very candid response. Thanks. Lewis?
I think the point that Tavish made, that the critical concept here is loser's consent. If all parties sign up to a piece of legislation and agree to abide by the result, you can't then turn around after the result and say, actually, we didn't like that. It was critical to the independence referendum that the SNP said not only that they'd accept the result, but that they'd accept it for a generation. You can have an argument about whether they've withdrawn some of that loser's consent, but nonetheless, at the time the referendum was held, there was a clear understanding that this was a one-off and that all parties would accept the result. I think the same applies here too. But I think your second question, does an election trump a referendum? Absolutely it does, because I think that's, again, fundamental to the unwritten constitutional tradition which is established in this country, that if a referendum is held by a government, which then gets, whether it gets the result it wants or not, if it has not implemented that decision by the time the next election is held, it is entirely open to other parties to stand on a platform that says, this is the outcome we want. Now, it's then a political judgment, whether it's for the Labour Party or for another party, do we want to say in our manifesto we're going to disregard this referendum? But legally and constitutionally, I don't think there's any debate about it. I think politically the judgment has to be, what is it, given the circumstances we're in by the time the next election comes, what is it that is possible? Certainly from my point of view, what is it that is possible in terms of retaining those benefits of our European relationship? And I think that will be a very interesting debate come the next general election.
Ross, brief comment.
Was the referendum legitimate? Yes, I think it was. It certainly wasn't resounding, though. A written constitution, yes, that would be massively helpful, not just for situations where you're having a referendum, but looking at the post-referendum situation that we're in now, a written constitution would be incredibly helpful, particularly for the intergovernmental relations within the UK, for then how we negotiate with Europe. I would be deeply uncomfortable with setting thresholds higher than a simple majority for a referendum. I think you then move into a position of not quite trusting the public, and we've already got an issue with this referendum where in the post-match analysis there were some very patronising conclusions made about Leave voters and their motivations for leaving. I think Lewis makes a strong point about elections after referendums being able to supersede them. That's correct. It would leave us in a deeply uncomfortable position, though, where a high turnout referendum could potentially be overturned by a low turnout election. That's not a situation anyone particularly wants to be in, but that is our constitutional tradition for all it's not been written down particularly well.
Okay, thanks. Jackson?
The interesting thing about the 2014 Scottish independence referendum is that every party in the Scottish Parliament supported it. It therefore had a broad consensus that the issue should be resolved in a national referendum. I mean, if we were to have a second referendum just now, that would not be the case. There are clearly several parties who would be opposed to the basis of the referendum being held. And the interesting thing about the European referendum we've just had is that every Conservative voted for it, every Labour MP voted for it at second reading, only one voted for it against it at third reading, that was Dennis Skinner. Every Liberal Democrat who voted for it, the Green MP voted for it, albeit the Scottish National Party MPs did not. But again, the European referendum, in terms of its legitimacy, was underpinned by a very broad cross-party consensus in the House of Commons that allowed that vote to take place. The language about it, David Dimbleby, well, I mean, that's the same margin President Obama beat John McCain by in his first presidential election, and that was called a landslide. So sometimes, percentages can be however you want to represent them in the outcome of an election. But I think the general consensus afterwards was, surprising as it was to many of us, that that was the result. It was a legitimately held referendum. It was a legitimate result at the end of the day. I agree with Lewis, actually, on whether or not a parliamentary general election could overturn. I actually believe in representative parliamentary democracy. In a way, the series of referendums we've had have shaken my support for referenda slightly, because, if you like, the Scottish National Party has been on the losing side of each of the three referenda in the last 5 years. They were for proportional representation, it was rejected. They were for independence and it was rejected. And they were for staying in the European Union and it was rejected. And their response to all three has to be say, well, let's have another referendum. So if you're not going to accept the outcome of a referendum, I'm not really sure what the point of having it is. And I am aware, because people have said to me, you know, we have a representative democracy. If I don't like the decision you take, I can get rid of you. The problem is there is no mechanism, because no government underpinned the Leave argument in this referendum. There is no way, in fact, that they are ever going to be held accountable as an organisation for the decision we now have. So, yes, I think at a general election, it would be open to any party to fight that election and seek to win a mandate on the basis that it would be able to have a majority, either in coalition or with others, to set aside the decision of the referendum, I think it would be an incredibly complicated and difficult thing to do. And I'm not certain, in fact, given the expression of will in a very high turnout referendum, that that's what will happen.
Okay, thanks, Jackson. Last but not least.
Yeah, I think some of the comments that have been made in the question itself probably highlights the democratic deficit that Scotland faces and which this EU referendum result has really opened up. Jackson talked about the cross-party support. Well, obviously, as he said, that didn't include SNP MPs who received 50% of the vote in Scotland and one of the highest ever turnouts in a general election, and that in itself highlights the democratic deficit. And in the run-up to the referendum, the First Minister and the other devolved administrations asked the UK government to sign up to a lock deal that every part of the UK, all the UK nations, had to agree on being taken out of Europe, and that was rejected. So I think it's worth remembering that in this narrow referendum result, when Scotland voted very decisively to remain, that it has opened up this huge democratic deficit question. And I think it's worth remembering that during the Scottish independence referendum, when we asked the question why people were voting yes, what was most likely to make people vote yes, it was actually the fundamental principle that people in Scotland should make the decisions about what happens in Scotland. And that's why I think that this referendum result in the medium to long term is going to have really profound implications on this constitution in Scotland. In terms of the issue of getting a Brexit deal and taking it back to people, I think morally that was, you know, like there's a good argument for that. I think by the time we've thrashed out a Brexit deal, whatever that looks like, I think the public will be much better informed about Europe and EU issues than they were when they voted in the referendum. However, as someone else said, in terms of practical politics, that's just not going to happen. And we're not going to, in terms of a general election overturning the deal, we're not going to see a general election which Labour wins, which the Conservatives are going to be hold on to power for a long time. So it's a hypothetical question. And just to comment on the last point that Tavish made about the legitimacy of the referendum, he suggested that people were lied to and were misinformed, which probably is the case. My argument would be that people were lied to and misinformed on the independence referendum because they were told that they voted no, they would stay in the EU.
Okay, thank you. Here's an exercise in democracy. I have time for the gentleman's question. Sorry, sir, we've got very short time, but one question from yourself and very brief responses because the MSPs have got to return for a debate or a discussion, I think, in Brexit in the Parliament. Over to you.
Edward Harkins here as an engaged citizen. I wanted to ask the panel, is it feasible for the UK government to approach the Brexit terms on the basis of a set of established values and principles with a strategic idea of what it really wants, whereas the reality is that it's going to have to play a very tactical game and simply get the best it can in each situation, whether that's financial passports, the City of London, fishing, single market. The EU seems very likely to play a very, very hardball game, and we've heard all about the highly politicised process today.
Okay, very brief responses. Tavish?
I think it'll be a messy, very messy compromise on detail and nothing to do with big principles.
Okay, Ross?
I think we can go into it with principles and they'll very quickly fall apart. There's a strong argument for having red lines, but the political reality is that's just not going to happen. This is about political will. The other side don't have the will to give us a good deal.
Okay, Jackson?
I think it's a good question. I think we will, as they've said, go in with principle. I think we might fight for some and we might even achieve some, but I think it'll be more of the latter than the former.
Lewis?
There will be lots of tactics, that's absolutely right, but I do think there is a single question that the UK government has to answer at the outset, and that is, are we seeking membership of the single market? Until that's clear, everything else is pure tactics, and I think we need to understand the strategic objective and then recognise that there'll be horse trading around how to achieve it.
Okay, Joan?
Well, they can't agree on what they want, so I think it will be a mess, and I find it very scary.
Okay, well, look, I think parliamentarians have got to go back genuinely for a debate, but I'd like to thank them. It's a pity we didn't have much longer for questions, because as the questions go on, you find out what the politicians really think, and they open up, and that's the best part of any discussion. But look, please join with me in thanking them for the contribution this afternoon. There'll be some quick changes on the top platform, bear with us. Okay, as I say, welcome back. The first academic panel is, as you say, dealing Brexit means Brexit, but what might Brexit mean? So again, we're very pleased to have an excellent group of contributors. So really, to maximise the time for yourselves later for questions, let's move, and I think Professor Laura Cram, University of Edinburgh, will talk first.
Okay, well, we've got quite an act to follow, really. The surfeit of professors thinking about it all now. And one of the things you're absolutely right, thanks so much for having us here today, and it'd be really nice to get your feedback, but one of the things that we have certainly found is that while we thought we were on our knees trying to inform people prior to the referendum, people have never been as hungry for information about Brexit as post the referendum. And I think that was probably summed up really nicely by the fact that the most Googled term the day after the referendum was, what is the European Union? Somewhat unnerving. Part of what we were also doing looking during the referendum was monitoring how people talked, really active people who used Twitter to discuss the European Union referendum. And what we found was it was a tiny percentage of the public conversation in English language across the whole year from August last year right up until June this year. And on the day after the referendum, our Twitter collection server actually collapsed because it went so far off the scale, and suddenly people discovered this was really something to talk about. So I've been asked to talk particularly about what the perspective from the EU perspective, if you like, is. And I'm going to start with something really general and very academic, and that one of my favourite authors writing on international relations and the development of international organisations like the European Union was Ernst Haas. And one of the things he talked about was you get certain times in international relations that they call turbulent fields. A time when so many things are changing and there are so many challenges to the system at exactly the same time that there is this sense of turbulence. So policymakers from different countries, from different institutions, different levels within the same countries are all trying to solve a problem, but nobody's quite sure which problem they're solving, and each of the solutions are related to one another, and it causes a really difficult time period. He describes it as being a bit like a giant simultaneous chess match over which the judges have lost control. And one of the things we've heard today in that conversation is how very difficult it is to find any certainties for us to offer in this conversation. And uncertainty is something, I know one of my colleagues will be talking about risk later, but uncertainty is one of the things that we find actually quite difficult as human beings and as decision makers. When we find ourselves in a context of uncertainty, often puts us into something like that kind of fright or flight, like the rabbit in the headlights moment, and it makes actual rational, careful decision making quite difficult. But the other side, and the thing that Haas emphasised, is that in that kind of policy vacuum that comes in a turbulent field, it's also important to note that everything is up for grabs. And that makes creativity, alternative solutions. We've heard about things like the reverse Greenland model, whether we choose a Swiss model or the Icelandic model, for example. But one of the things that we haven't yet got is a UK model, or an RUK, rest of the UK model, if it's not going to be the same model for all parts of the UK. And one of the only reasons we don't have that is because it doesn't yet exist. But this is the moment for thinking and thinking about what the boundaries of the possible, if you like, are. Internally, our focus has been very much on Article 50, when it's going to be triggered, what's going to be the timing, what role the various parliaments, whether in Westminster, we've just had a House of Lords report on this as well, or whether the devolved parliaments will play a role in it. But there's also huge pressure from the EU on this triggering of the Article 50 process. There's the questions we've already heard about elections. And there is a pressure to get rid of that uncertainty. One of the pressures that comes in wishing to see that article triggered is because it's not just the UK that's in this period of uncertainty, but the 27 other member states, not knowing what's happening in the Brexit process, are also facing that process, as are their domestic constituents, their industries, their own internal pressures are there and being brought to bear on them. And they're also being asked to respond to their publics and say, well, what kind of certainty can you offer us? So the story that we seem to be getting from the EU is that there's not an appetite to be punitive to the UK. Not arbitrarily, if you like, punitive, just because we were so mean they're going to take their ball away and now we'll never get to play with them again. But that there is a real and genuine concern about the possibility of contagion. And there is also very, very deep scrutiny from others who already have some of those deals. So Switzerland, for example, who's seen limitations on its access to some of its deal with the EU because it wants to control freedom of movement, is going to be watching very carefully for any attempt to get free movement with any kind of access to the single market. So there's a consciousness that there are other bodies in other countries that are also looking at exit options, and there's no desire to make that an easy option for others, so that contagion question. But also there is the very, very deep scrutiny of those who are also in complex relationships with the European Union. The European Union can't be seen simply to contradict itself and therefore, again, increase the pressure towards contagion. So yes, there is the uncertainty question, but there is also a need, if you like, to resist the inertia that comes often with that rabbit in the headlights moment, and a real need to be thinking, don't wait for Article 50. We need to be prepared. We need to have thought through what are our demands. And that applies as much here we've been talking about in Scotland, could be in Northern Ireland. The City of London has been very, very vocal about this. And for the UK, more generally, at the broader level with the European Union. This is the moment, if you like, to expand whatever the boundaries of the possible are in this debate. And as they very often say, never waste a good crisis. And don't forget, the European Union is continuing now. The Bratislava meeting is really symbolically important. So last week into this week, we've had the heads of the other 27 member states meeting without the United Kingdom. The flags flying outside their meetings were symbolically really important, the 27 flags of what they now see as the EU27. Brexit, not a major item on the agenda. Discussions about migration and border controls, about internal and external security, unsurprisingly, about economic and social development. But symbolically, the story and the production of that meeting was the Bratislava roadmap. And that Bratislava roadmap is for the EU27 to progress. It's already becoming normal at the EU level that Brexit is taking place. So the real challenge from our perspective is to make sure that whatever Brexit takes place, we've explored the most creative possible solutions and expanded every boundary of the possible to get the best deal that can be got out of that.
Okay, thanks very much, Laura. David?
Thank you. Certainly lots of turbulence, certainly lots of uncertainty, certainly lots of risk. But a fundamental problem, it seems to me, from the economics of this, how do you match up the single market, which is free trade in goods, services, and capital, with free movement of labour? You can't have everything you want, it seems to me. The history of the EU is such that countries that try to do that kind of deal don't get what they want. So what I'm going to try to do today is to think through some of these issues, maybe come up with some new thoughts, because to be honest, I've talked about this quite a lot. And if I keep saying there's an impasse, people will find me out and think, well, that's all he's got to say about this. But it is difficult, because basically this issue of mixing the single market and the and free movement doesn't seem to have any immediate solution to it. It's important in thinking too about the uncertainty and where we're going to realize that there are lots of different positions within Europe. That we can expect a power struggle within Europe to see which of these different positions actually is the one that becomes the dominant one at the table. So is it going to be German industry? Is it going to be Eastern Europeans who are worried about losing, say, remittances from the UK, which are quite major make a major contribution to their economy. So the different positions within Europe make everything even more difficult to predict. Just some things in terms of the general economics of this. First thing, gravity matters. Gravity in terms of how far markets are from each other. I saw someone lauding the possibility of a free trade deal with Australia. And you should read the Daily Mash on that deal because it is hilarious. You know, we don't have much in common actually, although other than a common heritage in economic terms with Australia, and whether having a free trade deal with Australia would be a huge benefit to the UK economy, I think is pretty questionable. Also got to think about the way that businesses work now, large-scale corporations, modern supply chains, very international, will have concerns about whether any deal that is arrived at will allow them to produce just-in-time cars or just-in-time engineering products and so on. So business will have a big voice. How important it will be remains to be seen. In general, economists take the view that reductions or increases in trade barriers have negative effects on GDP. I'll come back to that point. Let me say a few things about the different options. The Norwegian option, access to the market, free trade, free movement of labour, make a contribution about the same size as the UK does, and no say over regulation, although you keep agriculture and fisheries out of the deal. The EU is not that happy about the way some of these agreements are working. That's even more true of the next one, which is the Swiss option. The Swiss option is based on bilateral deals rather than a general agreement. So there are 120 sectoral agreements across Switzerland and the EU. They don't really have access to services, and the EU is now pretty fed up with organizing these deals. and thinks this is not a model, particularly after the decision by referendum not to accept free movement of labour. We've got an interesting deal that is on the cards for Canada, called the CETA, which actually, interestingly, is the only deal that allows a sub-state arrangement. So there is a special deal for Quebec in relation, I think, to public procurement. That's however, it has no free trade in services. And indeed, you know, these deals are really, really complicated. You just can't get away from that fact. Let me throw in a few things that maybe people haven't thought about. Public procurement, how governments buy goods and services, they're affected by these free trade deals. Big issue on TTIP would be, could American health companies bid for health services in Europe? Who sets up competition rules? That's another issue for trade agreements. What rules do you have on state aid? Can one country pour lots of money into its steel industry and still expect to have a free trade agreement with another country? How do rules of origin apply? Rules of origin are, what is the domestic content of something that you're exporting to a country that you have had a free trade deal? So if you get a car that's basically made in Mexico, but you brand it as British and then export it to the EU, what will be the situation? How do you resolve disputes? The dispute resolution mechanism is extremely important and has come up in TTIP. I'll discuss that in a sec. And then the whole area of services, to be honest, although it's our major export, there aren't many free trade deals that cover a significant proportion service exports or service trade. It is interesting that another thing to throw in, my last thing to throw in, is that we're now in a world where the general arguments that economists have put in favor of free trade are actually not doing so well. There's an argument that they are anti-democratic, and an example of that is TTIP, around issues like should American agriculture with, let's say, hormone additions to beef be allowed into Europe? Should haggis be exported to the US? At the moment, you can't. So those are the kind of nitty-gritty things. But this world where these kinds of arrangements, so TTIP has been described as dead by the one of the German ministers recently because of the kind of upswelling of argument against that. Some of its implications. So it's against that background that the UK is going to have to be going out there and trying to make its own deals, which is something also worth thinking about. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Professor Christina Boswell.
Thank you very much. Well, one of the key claims of the Leave campaign, as we know, was that Brexit would enable the UK to take back control over its immigration policy. And I think it's generally accepted that this claim was decisive in achieving a victory for the Brexit campaign in the referendum. But what does it mean to say the UK can take back control of immigration, and how far might it be feasible to expect this form of regain of control? So I'm going to very briefly touch on two aspects of this question. Firstly, what kind of deal might be negotiated which would imply this regain of control? What kind of deal, what would the deal look like? And secondly, in terms of implementing this kind of deal, what kind of control might we expect in terms of immigration? So first of all, on the type of deal, so as we all know, this kind of classic conflict is emerging between, on the one hand, the economic imperative to remain part of the single market, but the signals very clearly coming from Brussels and other European capitals that the UK can't cherry pick. We can't have our cake and eat it. Sorry to mix metaphors. We can't stay in the single market and restrict freedom of movement of workers. I still side with those commentators that are cautiously optimistic that some kind of compromise could be viable. It might be possible to negotiate some kind of emergency cap or emergency stop on the free movement or the immigration of EE nationals to the UK, so to have an emergency stop on access to the UK labour market, and that would involve the UK remaining in the single market, but having the possibility of having perhaps a seven-year stop or cap on EU immigration. And there are a number of precedents that can be built on. The EEA agreement includes such a cap, although, for Liechtenstein, and that's obviously a fairly exceptional case in terms of population, but that is a precedent. Also, we should recall that in the event of newly exceeding countries acceding to the EU, there is a possibility for existing member states to impose a five-year or up to seven-year stop on nationals of those exceeding countries accessing the labour market. So there are a number, there are other examples as well, but there are a number of sort of precedents about the possibility of imposing a seven-year, it's usually seven is the magic number, a seven-year stop or cap on EU immigration, and usually based on criteria of serious economic or societal difficulties or serious disturbances on the labour market. I suspect that it would be legally viable to craft something which the UK was deemed to meet the criteria of. But would it be politically acceptable? I think that's the big stumbling block. On the one hand, I mentioned EU concerns about cherry picking and this issue of contagion. On the other hand, would the UK public accept this as definitively regaining control? Partly it would depend on how it's sold by those negotiating the package. But given that such a stop would almost inevitably be temporary, I can't imagine it being anything more substantial than a temporary provisional stop. Would it be acceptable in terms of meeting concerns about immigration? The alternative, so scenario number two, would be leaving the single market. And there I think it's fairly widely agreed that, of course, that would enable the UK to limit free movement of workers from EEA countries. And it might be emerging as a more realistic scenario. But then I think we've got to think about, in both of these scenarios, but especially in the latter scenario, what sort of control would these provisions give over immigration from EEA countries? And here I come to the second question of implementation. So I think it's important to note that what's not on the table, politically speaking, is a blanket halt to EEA immigration. So, even the protagonists, some of the leading Conservative protagonists of Brexit, like Michael Gove, Boris Johnson, during the campaign, they were very careful not to say that they wanted a drastic reduction of EEA immigration. What they wanted was to be able to select those immigrants which are deemed useful, necessary for the UK economy. So it's about selection rather than aggregate or drastic aggregate reductions. And I think in this respect, it's also very, very relevant to recall how the UK government has fared since 2010 in reducing non-EEA immigration. So remember that net migration target, which is actually still in force, and the government recently reaffirmed its commitment to the net migration target of bringing net migration down from the hundreds of thousands to the tens of thousands. Well, they haven't achieved that even in the case of non-EEA nationals, let alone non-EEA plus EEA. So, after a raft of measures to try to reduce immigration and net migration of non-EEA nationals to the UK, non-EEA net migration stands at roughly 130,000 a year. Will they fare any better on EEA immigration? We had to think about why liberal democracies generally are really bad at controlling and limiting immigration. It's because there are very, very strong, inter alia, very, very strong business reasons to retain some leniency over immigration to meet economic demand in various sectors. There are severe shortages in various occupations for various sectors. We need skills in many areas. We also need low-skilled immigration to fill jobs that British nationals are unwilling or unable to do. So it's not evident that Having the legal possibility of severely restricting EEA immigration will translate into actually introducing measures which would drastically restrict EEA immigration. It's much more likely that even under scenario two, where we leave the single market, a UK government would bring in, would either expand existing provisions for non-EEA immigrants on the existing tier system, or would introduce new bespoke arrangements for ensuring that we are able to select EEA immigrants to come to the UK to work in those sectors most in need of labour. So we might actually end up with not very different numbers. Now, paradoxically, the best route to a drastic restriction of EEA immigration, if that's what voters want, is to reduce the demand for labour, so to reduce the need for businesses and the bits of the public sector to recruit immigrants from abroad. Now, how do we reduce demand for labour migration? Well, by weakening our economy. And how do we weaken our economy? Probably by leaving the single market. So actually, the result probably will be paradoxically that leaving the single market is probably the best bet to reducing immigration. The last question then I would finish on is this what we mean by taking back control?
Thanks very much, Christina. Michael?
In 2014, Scotland voted by 55% to remain within the United Kingdom. This year, it voted by 62% to remain within the European Union. The question I've been asked is, can we give effect to both these referendums? Can we stay in the United Kingdom and the European Union? And the answer is no. But I think I'm supposed to elaborate that a little bit. The European Union is many things, but principally it's two things. One is the political union, membership of the institutions, the Commission, the Council of Ministers, the European Parliament, participating in the policy-making structures of the European Union. And then there's the single market that my colleagues have mentioned on several occasions. This is the economic union, and both of them are bound rather strictly by treaties. As far as the political union is concerned, to be a member, you have to be an independent state. To join that, Scotland would have to be independent. If it's not independent, it can't be a member of the European Union. Non-state governments have all sorts of ways of participating in the European Union, but only because their member state is. So Scotland operates in Europe because it's part of the United Kingdom. The economic union is the single market, which is a set of rules and regulations intended to ensure a level playing field. It is a customs union. It's not just a free trade area, but there are all kinds of rules about product standards, regulations upon which are built social dimensions. It's a highly institutionalized and very dense set of regulations. And once again, you're either in it or you're not in it. So just imagine, could Scotland stay in the single market if the rest of the UK were to leave the single market? That would imply an economic boundary between Scotland and England, customs posts, all the rest of it, checks on product standards, rules of origin that David was talking about earlier on. That is the one thing that nobody wants. All sides in this debate have been agreed for a long time that that would be terribly bad. Even if Scotland were to leave the United Kingdom and remain in the European Union, once again, you've got that single market border between Scotland and England. Now, that may be what happens, but those are the consequences of it, because you can't pick and choose what you take from the single market. It comes as a package. So what else can be done? Scotland will remain in the single market to the degree that the UK stays in the single market. And that's why all the MSPs we had here seem to be of the view that they wanted the UK to remain in the single market so that Scotland should be in the single market. And the SNP itself wants the UK to remain in the single market so Scotland could remain in the single market. And eventually, they might take a decision about independence on the basis that both Scotland and the rest of the UK would be in the single market as separate states. Meanwhile, we've heard a lot of stuff about reverse Greenlands, pick and choose, bespoke solutions for Scotland, none of which are really feasible because of what I've just said. Let's take this reverse Greenland notion. Greenland left the European communities as it then was in 1979. The Faroe Islands, actually, which were also part of Denmark, never joined. So they can be outside the European Union even when Denmark is in. Leave aside the fact that they are small in population terms and small in geographical terms, as far as the Faroe Islands. Small places in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean and Scotland is not. Greenland option for the United Kingdom would mean the UK staying in the European Union, but that little bit of it called England and Wales would come out. And Scotland and Northern Ireland would somehow have to represent a state called the United Kingdom and take all the big decisions. It's just not going to happen. So what are the other possibilities? What is Plan B, what is Plan C, and so on for Scotland? Well, there are certain things that Scotland can do to stay within European policy-making networks, to stay part of Europe without necessarily being a member of the European Union. This is not to be confused with being in the EU and not being in the EU at the same time. One thing that will happen after Brexit is that a lot of competences that are currently shared between Scotland and Europe will revert to Scotland, unless Westminster intervenes to try and take them back again. That's the way that the devolution settlement was devised. Anything not reserved to Westminster is Scottish, including a lot of the European stuff. The biggest items include agriculture and fisheries, environmental policy, aspects of energy policy, some aspects of social policy. We've got the whole of education, of course, but that's mainly not Europeanized, but higher education is. So there may be some scope, if we came out of the European Union, for Scotland to try and stay in step more with Brussels than within London, to say, well, we're going to follow a European line on these kinds of things. Take environmental policy. If Brexit is all about reducing regulation, Scotland might say, well, we quite like environmental and social regulation, and we're going to maintain a higher standard. We're going to be part of the European framework for environmental policy. It might even make it easier for us to trade into European markets if we're respecting their standards. But that would be a unilateral decision by Scotland. We wouldn't participate. Take the question of the social dimension of Europe. There's talk in Europe at the moment about relaunching the social dimension, which is about labor market regulation and about protecting worker standards and extending this into other areas of social life. The UK government has said, no, we're not interested and we're leaving anyway. The Scottish government said, well, we're quite interested in doing that. That doesn't work through the normal EU policymaking process. It works through something called the open method of coordination, whereby governments move in parallel. Rural policy, environment, agricultural policy, similarly, there may be scope for Scotland to do things in parallel with Europe. And as far as the network is concerned of universities, which are deeply connected across Europe, civil society organizations, local government, they're quite keen in remaining part of these pan-European networks. So no, we can't be both in and outside the European Union at the same time. We can't be within the UK and the European Union if they are moving in separate directions. The best we can do is try and move in parallel with Europe, retaining some aspects of Europe, but is not to be confused with being within the European Union itself.
Thanks very much for that, Michael. Okay, it's your turn. Questions? Gentlemen here. What I'll do, I'll take maybe two or three questions and then we'll ask maybe individual members of the panel to respond so we can get more questions from the floor. Sir?
Thank you. So I'm interested in...
Sorry, who are you?
My name is Robert, a PhD student at Edinburgh University.
Thank you.
So I'm interested in the impact of Brexit on the UK-China relations. So could I know if any expert would like to comment on this from both political and economic perspectives?
Okay, thank you. Another question? Just behind. We've got volunteers. Sir?
Hi, Eddie O'Neill. The panel frequently has mentioned immigrants. Sometimes, as someone said to me yesterday at a Hustings debate, it's funny how people from Britain that live elsewhere are referred to as expats, and yet when they come to live here, they're called immigrants. Let me turn the conversation on its head. Rather than people who currently live here who are not British, if you like, or people who have come here from other European countries being asked to leave or not being allowed to come here in the first place, are we going to see the emptying of the Costa del Sol because all the Brits are going to have to come home?
Okay, thank you. Gentleman at the back.
Hi, my name is Andreas, and I just finished my PhD at the University of St. Andrews. I come from Greece, and political sobriety is something that we don't, it's not a prominent characteristic in Greek politics. For all the years I've been here, I thought, and even in the past, that political sobriety is something that has characterized British politics much more than other places I've been to. Of course, numbers and sizes are not comparable to Greece, of course. But where comparison is possible, I would like to draw attention to the fact that due to the economic crisis that Greece has faced in the last few years, we have seen a rise in nationalism. And with reference to that, I would like to ask you if you think that nationalism is another important concern that comes out from the discussion and the recent referendum, and if it is also another important issue to address aside from the economic concerns.
Okay.
Post-Brexit environment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, David, maybe Brexit on China?
Mr. Osborne memorably went to China, and the Chinese Premier travelled in the Golden Carriage, I think, with the Queen. Was that earlier this year or at the back end of last year? So we did have a policy, it seems to me, that of trying to encourage Chinese investment. We are in a sense reliant on foreign direct investment, and we are the major recipient in Europe of foreign direct investment. In the past, it has mainly been from the United States, but the UK government clearly saw an opportunity with China. Now, whether China equally now sees an opportunity, I guess, is a little bit more in question. And again, this will, at the end of the day, depend on the settlement that is arrived at. But foreign direct investment into the UK as a platform for going into the European market has to now be in a bit of doubt. And the uncertainty will mean probably that decisions will at any rate be delayed until such time as there is clarity about the way in which Chinese companies will be able to access the European market should they choose to site themselves within the UK. So I think my view is that Brexit will at best result in a stalling of the British-Chinese economic relations.
Okay, thanks, David. Christina, what about this one then? As part of our immigration thinking, we're going to depopulate the Costa del Sol.
Quite frankly, deportation is immensely complex and difficult for governments to implement, fortunately. I mean, I think the wider issue is around what will be the rights of EU residents who have been in the UK, or UK emigrants, let's call them, who've been resident for a number of years in other EU countries. So at the moment, there's a 2004 directive called the Citizens Directive, which sets out the rights of EU nationals who are resident in other countries. And that states that after a period of continual residence of 5 years, EU nationals automatically have a right to permanent residence in the EU country in which they're settled. So there will be many hundreds of thousands of EU nationals in the UK, for example, who qualify for that right at the moment, and many, hundreds of thousands of UK nationals abroad who qualify for that right as well. The question is, post-Brexit, will that right still hold, or is there a possibility for it to be rescinded? in the UK legally. I don't think there's any constitutional protection which would mean that Parliament couldn't legislate that that right would be rescinded. Politically, I see it as absolutely unfeasible to imagine that any future UK government, even a future UKIP government, would rescind a right to permanent residence which has already been bestowed upon on EU nationals. And that would partly also be because of the impossibility again of deporting. Can you imagine a scenario where UKBA starts deporting dawn raids on EU nationals? Polish families with young children integrated into local schools, being forcibly deported back to... I really cannot see that happening politically. So, I mean, I think the reason the UK government, one of the reasons they're not giving stronger assurances, they say it's going to be part of the negotiation package and so on, but I think probably they don't want to create a pull effect whereby if they say, yes, if you've been resident for 5 years in the UK at the point at which the UK leaves the European Union, you automatically have this right to permanent residence. They probably don't want to... create an incentive for additional EU immigration now. That's my suspicion.
Okay, thanks, Christina. Michael, on the Greek question in terms of the growth of nationalism, which is pretty evident in a lot of countries within Western Europe just now, what's your response?
One of the things that's at the root of the discontents that are sweeping Europe and the whole of the Western world at the moment is a protest against what we used to call globalization until we realized that was probably too sweeping a term. But forces that seem to operate at the supranational level that people don't control, whether it's big corporations or financial markets or trade deals negotiated in secret, and people feel that they have lost control, to use a favorite term of the Brexit campaign, which is why that term had such resonance. The problem is, what does getting back control really mean in a complex world? And here we have a lot of rather simplistic solutions. Well, let's go back to the nation state, let's claim sovereignty, which are really rather illusory, because you can give people the pretense, the appearance of sovereignty without the substance. So Greece is a sovereign state, but it's actually a lot less sovereign at the moment than Scotland is, if you regard sovereignty as being able to control your own affairs. And if we look at the value of nationalism, well, nationalism can be very positive in some ways because it gives people a pride in who they are and where they come from, and creates a sense of solidarity and a sense of political community and supports democratic institutions. And it has another side, which is the xenophobic, inward-looking nationalism that we've seen across Europe. And one of the great failings of the European Union is that it's not being able effectively to deal with that and reconnect with people and show that what it's doing is relevant to their lives. The EU was supposed to be the antidote to extreme nationalism, which culminated in the two world wars of the 20th century. It's failed to do that, and so the EU itself has become the target of nationalist movements. And if one looks at what's happening in France, and some of the Eastern European countries, indeed some of the Nordic countries we used to admire so much, there is a growth of this inward-looking nationalism. And without condoning it, we have to accept that there are reasons why people are frustrated and thus turn to those extreme, if rather illusory, solutions.
Okay, thanks for that. Laura?
Okay, just following up. Well, my undergraduate studies were on Greek language and politics, so my baptism came in Greek politics, and this has fascinated me for a long time. One of the stories, I think, in terms of identity, following on Mike's points, is that although when we're in the UK context, we tend to talk a lot about the Scottish national identity, actually one of the most interesting things that probably came out of this in terms of national identity is that while English identity and UK identity have tended to be seen as rather synonymous, so the Union Jack very much seen as much as part of being English, that one of the things that's emerged is that there's a real sense that as you've seen a growth of powers in Scotland and in Wales, that there's been a sense of that the English national identity is not being satisfied institutionally. So we have seen that, and that was part of this referendum conversation, where they feel challenged both inside and outside in terms of migration as well. So there's definitely been an identity issue too in within the EU referendum here. But Greece particularly is really interesting in that, in terms of its identity in relation to the EU, in that although even at its highest, when it really, really supported EU membership, It was always one of the very lowest identifiers with the European Union. And that's because there always has been a tradition of occupation and a strong sense of what national identity actually means within Greece. So I think there can be all sorts of different pressures that are relevant there too.
Okay, thank you. Gentlemen here at the front, and then gentlemen yellow afterwards.
I'm Roger Jeffrey from the University of Edinburgh. Two rather different points I want to make. One was to ask Christina to respond to Michael, because xenophobia is a remarkably powerful force for getting rid of people you don't like on an informal and not necessarily legal basis. And I immediately think of the clearances of people we think of as genocide, or not quite genocide, but the Punjab example is one that strikes me as very strongly. And the other question is perhaps more for Laura, but also for David. What does the EU want from a post-Brexit Britain?
Okay, gentlemen.
That's an interesting question. I wish I'd asked that one. David Hood, I'm a competitiveness specialist and a member of Business for Scotland. It was disappointing the last session because perhaps we didn't see any light. And taking Laura's point about us all being stuck in the headlights like rabbits, and indeed, if I'd asked the question of the previous panel, they'd fall into dogma. But perhaps you guys are a little bit more, you've got a bit more latitude. What do you reckon, not what could happen, but what do you reckon would be the best way forward? Because we seem to be abdicating responsibility to a headless government down south, and nobody's really standing here going, here's what should happen. On your personal opinion. Thank you.
Okay, I don't know, I think we do personal opinions, but I'm sure we can have a stab at it. Well, hang on, I don't want you to monopolise questions, but I'm quite happy to come. Yep, Kirsty.
Thank you, Kirsty Hughes. I think my question follows on from the last one a bit, but it also covers, in a sense, not only both panels, but I think the way the debate is going in the UK at the moment, and that is this. It's a very typically British focus on the single market. You know, we said we wanted to take back control because we've got this political monster called Europe. And then once we voted for Brexit, actually all we care about is the single market and apparently staying in it after all. So I had sort of two challenges on that. One is this tendency to say, well, if we could only sort out the free movement problem, we could be in the single market and that would be great, but obviously we wouldn't have a voice and a vote anymore. So the idea that Remainers are meant to think this is a great soft Brexit argument, have a big problem with. But I think the bigger point surely is that when you look at the turbulence in Europe at the moment, you look at Russia and Ukraine, Russia's influence in the Western Balkans, chaos in the Middle East, North Africa and so on and so forth, and whether the EU is going to survive and therefore whether the single market is going to survive. And what Britain's done by its vote is say, we're abdicating any responsibility for that, we're throwing away any influence over that. And surely Scotland and the UK's biggest concerns and interests at the moment, given the state of Europe, should be in those wider concerns. So are we a bit missing the point with this focus and almost obsession with the single market?
Okay, thank you. I think, Christina, you were invited to respond to Michael on question one.
Well, I think I'm responding to Roger, probably. This raises one of the most thorny and difficult aspects, I think, that's been sort of exposed by the referendum debate and what's happened afterwards. So the referendum, I think we all would all widely accept, has in many ways legitimised forms of anti-immigrant sentiment, which have just become, as the Germans would say, salonfähig. They have a lovely term for that. They're, you know, feasible to mention in salon conversation. So I think this raises two sets of issues. One is that issue about public understanding of the impacts of immigration and to what extent anti-immigrant sentiment is based on misperception about the impacts of immigration and so on. And that debate gets you into the whole expert versus democracy, etc., so on. But the other issue is, what do we consider in a liberal democratic society to be morally and legally legitimate positions to take or claims to make vis-a-vis immigration restriction? So it's obviously not in the realms of the politically, ethically, legally possible to deport British nationals of ethnic minority groups who have British passports and are full members of British society. Neither is it probably ethically or legally acceptable to rescind rights, I think, of permanent residents who've been settled here and integrated in the long term. Is it ethically, legally viable to limit immigration in a way that would cripple the economy? Is it viable to limit immigration in a way that would be profoundly discriminatory? So generally in these debates, the protection of the rights of long-term residents and existing members of our community tend to be protected, firewalled, but then what's up for grabs is much more the issue of who do we admit now and on what basis and so on. But I think throughout all these debates, I mean, really, this issue of what is a legitimate claim in terms of immigration restriction, what can we legitimately expect the public to decide on, given that they might have, to many political and other elites, might have unpalatable preferences and might be basing their preferences on claims which we would think were misinformed. And what kind of debate can we have given those issues? How much should we open up for scrutiny and for choice and for deliberation? And how much do we just have to say, sorry, we bracket that off. We're a liberal democracy, we cannot go there. I don't know the answer to that, and I don't know what kind of fora we could have these debates in. I think this is a really hugely important but very difficult question, and should be something that we really think about in Scotland, where I think we tend to be a bit complacent. We say, oh, we're not like the rest of the UK, we're much more favourable to immigration and so on. I'm not sure there's much evidence to support that, so my worry is that we need to think about these issues in Scotland as well.
On the question of, you know, what does the EU need out of this? David first, and then maybe Laura.
I think talking on the economics to start off with, EU would, I think, want the UK to be a stable economy and a good market for the many goods that it produces, or a continuing market for the many goods that it produces. Going beyond that a bit, it's interesting to speculate, I guess, on how, you know, the UK and the way that it is will be used within political debate and economic debate within Europe. So will the Germans and the Nordics say that, well, the UK is doing it this way, let's not do it the Mediterranean way? So it is interesting, I think, that gravity will still be there. We will still be a large economic force sitting very close to the rest of the EU, and that will be bound to affect the nature of political and economic debate within Europe. Whether for the good or the bad, I don't know, but we'll be out there as an exemplar of something different.
Laura?
Yeah, I think that's a particularly good question on what is the EU. It's always the first lecture to the undergraduates, as you exactly say, there is no such thing as the European Union. So please don't say the European Union once in any of your essays. And I think that's really, really important here. You're talking about 27 member states. The big trick of the European Union was there was always lots of multiple imaginings of what it meant to each one, and it meant different things. It was a political project for those who were coming out of dictatorships to show that they were democratic. Single market was priority for others. Peace was the priority for others. And that's what made the European Union what it was, that each of these member states could really sell to their own publics that it was something different. And I think that does leave us with that question. Lots of people have been asking, and in Bratislava, I thought it was really interesting that the statement of the council members was, the EU is not a perfect instrument, but it's the best instrument that we have to address these challenges. So there is a recognition, even amongst the EU27, that reform is needed. Been a lot of pressure for a long time now to go back to core business and to stop dabbling perhaps in areas that aren't as essential and just annoy publics really around the European Union, and really get a sense of, well, what is the EU? What does it mean to all of us? But that's a really big project. In terms of what should you do,
I think maximising voice, the actual practical thing is maximising voice, identifying priorities. Michael talked about the range of competencies that might be taken back, for example, to Scotland that are EU competencies. It's not just finding the competencies, it's also having the instrument to be allowed to act. Currently, we can't act on foreign relations because that is a reserved business, so that would also affect creating new relationships with others. So countries such as Belgium actually have instruments that allow devolved polities to negotiate the international aspects of relationships within their devolved areas. So it's not just looking for the areas, but also looking for the competencies.
Okay, thanks. I think, Michael, that maybe you can take that point that, you know, let's not trust Theresa May, let's not trust the government, let's not trust the cabinet packed out with failed Brexiteers. What do you think, Michael? What's the best way forward?
Tying that into Kirsty's comment about the EU not just being about economics, I think the big choice we're faced with is what kind of political economic system that we're going to have, because the European model, there are different models within Europe, but the European model is based upon something called the social market economy. That's a regulated market economy accompanied by a welfare state and social compromises that allow high levels of social integration and high levels of social welfare, which is in contrast to what happens elsewhere in the world. And if we're faced the choice of do we stick with Europe or do we go into global markets just on our own, that's the question that arises. And this is something which divided the Brexit campaign, never mind separated the Brexit campaign for the others. And it underlies all of this argument about whether we're going to go to the WTO route or the single market or whatever. Because there is a strand of opinion that says we would do very well without Europe. It's just a burden, it's over-regulated, it's over-bureaucratic, the social costs are too high. Spin ourselves off into global markets, we will compete on the basis of low costs as a lean, stripped-down competition state. And examples then are given of places that do this that are very, very different from Scotland. Now, that's a perfectly viable model. It's not one that I would subscribe to, but it's one way of doing things. On the other hand, if we maintain our predominant pattern of trade with Europe, we're trading with people who also have high welfare costs, who also have large scales and generous public services, and therefore we can afford to do that ourselves. That's what underlies a lot of this, and which reminds us that Europe is not just a matter of economics in the narrow sense, it's about a model of society and what are the conditions under which we can sustain that distinct model of society. On that, people will differ, but the center of gravity in Scotland on that dimension is a little bit different to what it is in England.
Okay, hopefully, Kirsty, that kind of combined a bit with your own question. I have two speakers, short time, so quick questions, really quick answers. Gentleman at the front here first, and then behind.
Andrew Anderson, could I take out something that Laura Cram said just now and perhaps connect it with Michael Keating's last point? It seems to me that Britain joined the EU for a totally different reason from any of the other 27, and that essentially is why we've left or are going to leave. None of the dynamics which apply to those 27 applied in our case, I think. However, it may be that they do apply or will apply in Scotland's case. And I wonder if that's something which members of the panel might have views about and theories about how Scotland could advance its interests best with that in mind in the future.
Okay. Laura, can you take that one?
Yeah, I think that fits very well with exactly what you're seeing happening in practice. There's a very different rationale for what the EU means and what the understanding of it was. Even the background of why, what we saw in the independence referendum, the focus that came in the European Union on that was deeply relevant, I think, to what was the outcome of this referendum as well. So, yeah, I think that will play out significantly.
Okay, thanks, Laura. Gentlemen.
You're Dickie of the Financial Times. I'm interested in the panellists' views on how the negotiations that the UK pursues for Brexit will proceed, particularly what kind of cards both sides have to play and how they might play them. And on that, the degree to which the triggering Article 50 means that the UK loses all its leverage, as some people believe, or as I've seen recently argued by Jean-Claude Pru, that in fact the UK could later on rescind its decision to trigger Article 50 and would therefore have leverage as a result. What does the panellists think of this? Thank you.
Thanks very much for the good question. I think we'll just go right along the panel. Michael?
There's a lot of tactical manoeuvring around this. I think the EU, having declared its intention to leave, has already played its best card and is going to be in a weak position from now on. Delaying Article 50 is seen as being a way of gaining time and strengthening our bargaining position, but I think other member states are going to run out of patience very soon. They gave Cameron a break at the time of his so-called renegotiations. They were getting very impatient before the last election and said, well, sort this out within a few months and then decide. Otherwise, we just got other things to look at. The other member states, if you go to the, you read the European newspapers, you don't see very much about Brexit. You see a huge amount about the euro crisis, about the migration crisis, about what's going on in Ukraine and why the EU doesn't have an effective foreign policy. Brexit is way down the agenda there. So the basic answer to your question, Muir, is I think we're in a weak position to begin with, and the longer it goes on, the weaker our position will be.
Okay. David?
I agree with Michael there. I think the UK is not in a very strong position. It is actually a very open economy anyway. It hasn't, if you think about it, the kind of trade negotiations that the UK will have to engage in following an agreement with the EU, the UK will not be in a particularly strong position as far as these are concerned. That will impact, in a sense, on the EU negotiations, because the EU will know that. You know, it seems to me that the costs of the negotiations will actually be part of the negotiation, because the UK is looking at a very long period of negotiation, and the rest of the EU will know that and will use that against the UK to try to force through a deal that maybe at the moment the Cabinet couldn't agree upon.
Okay, final point, Laura.
Yeah, and just one of the things, I think by delaying indefinitely, you also have to remember that you're already seeing the EU27 moving on. So that kind of normalisation of simply the UK being out is becoming more and more embedded. I think the other thing to just remember here is the UK was always an awkward partner. For some of the member states, this is a bit of a shrug your shoulders, and thank goodness they can't block that and they can't block that. And particularly some of the things we've seen in the Bratislava statement on internal and external security, border controls, were always areas where the UK was a bit difficult. So, you know, yeah, I wouldn't underestimate the relief from some of them as well.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Well, it's 3 o'clock coffee time, but first of all, can you join with me in thanking our panel this afternoon?